field.
Me?
I'm actually looking for something. And no, it's not a bear, a bison, or a wolf, or anything like that. I'm actually looking for something small. And, well, now that you guys are here, would you mind giving me a hand? Taking a look? Let's see. No, that's not it. No. Huh. There it is. Do you see it? Do you see the small beetle over there? That's what I'm looking for. It's a tiger beetle. And okay, I can already hear you thinking, why in the world is she looking for a silly beetle when you're in Yellowstone? And there's so much other cool stuff. But actually, this beetle is really awesome. Oh, went too far. There you go. This beetle is so awesome because, first of all, it's living on top of a super volcano, okay? That's really cool. Second of all, it lives near thermal features with a pH of 2.2, like sulfuric acid, temperatures of 65 Celsius, which is about 149 Fahrenheit. Some are radioactive, and then we have toxic heavy metals such as arsenic, so mind blown. How are these guys alive? It doesn't make any sense because everything else should die under such conditions, but for some reason, and I mean it's pretty obvious, they don't need our help. They're doing just fine over here. So, okay, anyway, moving on, how are these beetles alive? To me, that's my main question. I'm so intrigued by it. So in 2006, my advisor went to Yellowstone National Park and he found these beetles. Fast forward, 10 years later, I come into play. So I went to Yellowstone National Park and I was looking for one, 10 years later, are these beetles still there? Two, where exactly can we find them? And then three, what kind of environment are they living in? So I drove around the entire park, stopped at every thermal feature that was accessible to the public, and I looked for these tiger beetles. And wouldn't you know it, I found them at five sites. So jumping up and down, I was really excited because yes, now I can start my doctoral research. And then I look over and I see all these tourists looking at me like, what is wrong with this girl? Made a fool of myself, I'm probably making a fool of myself now. But you know, if you're excited about science, you don't really care. So now that I have found the beetles, the next step came, doing observational work. What time do they become available? What time do they become active? When do they become inactive? What types of behaviors do they have? And what kind of environment are they actually living in? So a really cool way to recognize these tiger beetles is they're predators, and they run really fast and they stop. They run really fast and they stop because they run so fast that their eyes can't catch up with them. So they literally turn blind as they're running, so they have to stop and look, where's my prey? So when you're out in the field and you see something run, stop, it's probably a tiger beetle. So after I got my first data about these tiger beetles, it was time to put together a permit so I could actually work in Yellowstone. And if I can just grab this here. It took a little bit less than a year and 40 pages later, back and forth with the park to actually get approved to work there. So a lot of blood, sweat, and tears went into this. But needless to say, I was really happy when I finally got approved. And other than the scientific content, you know, what do I want to study? Why do I want to study it? And how am I actually going to do it? Yellowstone was very adamant about putting in a safety protocol because you may have heard it's very dangerous in Yellowstone and deaths do actually happen. So we have to make sure that we avoid that at all costs. So part one, thermal features. So Yellowstone is on top of a hot spot. So that means that certain areas are thermally active, others are not. Just one earthquake can totally change it. So an area that's thermally active one day can be not active the other day and vice versa. So because it's active, some of the soil could be eroded away underneath. So soil that looks perfectly fine one day, but you step on it, you fall through, and you burn yourself, you could die. Very dangerous. So part of the protocol is this little guy. And we have to test the soil, move around. It looks stupid, but it's for your safety. And make sure that the soil is very sturdy so that you can walk on it. Another way to test this is an infrared gun. So I look at the temperature of the soil, and if there's one spot that all of a sudden is really hot, avoid that area. Just don't go there. And there's other tricks that we know where to go and where it's safe. And the second part is wildlife encounters. And I'm sure you've heard about grizzly bear attacks and deaths. It happens. So a couple of the things that we do is we're always in groups of three. It's been shown when you're in a bigger group than three, well, than two, bears are likely to avoid you. So we're always with three. We carry this little guy, our bear spray. To be honest, I don't know if it would actually work. I mean, if it wants to kill you, I'm sure it will. But it, you know, it's nice to have at times. And then we always have one person on watch. So when we're working, there's someone else that's always looking around to see that there's no wildlife nearby. And then lastly, we had to put something in about tourists. Now, tourists are not gonna kill us, but you'd be surprised how many tourists think, oh, these people are working over there, so I can go there too. Yeah, that's not the case. We know where to go, how to get there, and there are a lot of areas that you shouldn't go, and they don't know that. So part of our permit, and why I'm looking ridiculous, is so that tourists know that we're official. We have to put a permit on display so they know that we're actually working there for a reason. And then we also need to have someone on watch to make sure that these tourists aren't not trying to come towards us. So we've had a couple of incidences where tourists would bother us when we're trying to work. I'm recording data because I'm observing these beetles, and they'll ask questions, and well, I just lost all that data. But there was one instance where one tourist actually saved our lives. So I'm recording these beetles, I'm sitting down, I'm looking at the beetles, so you'll hear me the loudest, but I want you to pay attention on what's happening in the background, okay?
How hot is it?
Hot.
Too hot.
You're not gonna go hot potting?
No, I think we're good today.
You have a temperature reading on it?
Yeah, it's about 60. Celsius.
Running. Stop. Running. Stop. Running.
Hey, behind you.
Stop.
Guys.
Yeah.
Running.
There.
There?
There.
Oh, shit. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, bear.
Hey, bear.
Hey, bear.
Gotta move. Slow back away, guys.
Yeah. So, one person in our group wasn't paying attention and wasn't doing their job because there was a bear right behind us. So thank God the tourist saw and notified us. But to be fair, it wasn't an attacking grizzly bear. Oh, there you go. It was a little black bear cub. So I was really angry at one of my undergraduate students for not following protocol, moving away, and he took this picture instead. But obviously right now, I'm really happy he took that picture. And then it came to the research. So like I said, we did observational work, did pH, did soil samples, water samples to look at what the environment is, what the toxins are. And it turns out regular tiger beetles, when it gets too hot, they will run in the shade, they will bury in the ground, or they'll do something like stilt, where they lift their body up off the ground to cool off. Our beetles, they did not care. They didn't do any of this behavior, and they're faced with a lot higher temperature, so what's going on there? And then toxicity was 1,000 times higher than the EPA threshold. It would kill us, but it doesn't kill them. So part of what I'm going to be continuing to do is have a colony in the lab and actually see when they die. So it sounds a bit, you know, questionable, but you know, biology is use a couple to save a lot. So then lastly, I want to end by saying that Yellowstone National Park was really the first time I felt like a real scientist, because rather than being told what to do, I had to come up with my own questions. I had to drive by myself in the park and look for these beetles, had to put a permit together, and then now I'm taking undergraduate students with me in the park, and I'm delegating and showing them, you know, the ropes of research. So with that, I'd like to thank my advisor for giving this opportunity for me to grow as a scientist and to improve myself every day. But now I gotta go find beetles, so bye. Ha ha.